stand and we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. How many of you are glad to be in the house of God? He's a good God. Thank you, Jesus. We just come to you to just worship your name. Father, we just come to this place to glorify and lift up the name of Jesus. And as we come into your presence today, God, we lay aside everything and focus on you. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said, amen.
All right, let's go around and love on one another and tell them you're glad that they're here today. And this song says, Jesus, I sing for all you've done for me. And when we think about what he's done for us, it's a good time to let him know how much we love and appreciate our Abba Father, Jesus, our salvation, our lover of our soul, our healer, everything that we need. We just thank him.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Oh, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Oh, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy of this. this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Come on and lift your voice. This is amazing grace. Tell him right now, this is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. You give life. You are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
Come on, we're going to shout his great name. Lift your voice with us.
All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Oh, great are you, Lord. Come on and tell him right now. Oh, great, great are you, Lord. Oh, we worship you, Lord. You are great. Great are you, Lord. Oh, yes, you are, Lord. You are great. Oh, great are you, Lord. It's your breath, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Oh, great are you, Lord. Oh, come on and tell him right now. Great are you, Lord. Oh, one more time, tell them you are great. Are you, Lord? Oh, yes, you are, Lord.
Hope is built on nothing less.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. when darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Savior's love through the storm. He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak and made strong in the Savior. With trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Oh, we sing Christ alone, Christ alone. He's my cornerstone, weak and made strong in the Savior's love through the storm. He is Lord, Lord of all. Oh, Christ alone, Christ alone, you're my cornerstone, weak and made strong in the Savior's love through the storm. He is Lord, Lord of all. He is Lord. Oh, yes, you are Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak and made strong in the Savior's love through the storm. He is Lord, he's Lord of all.
You, Lord, we just give you praise, we give you glory, and we give you honor. And as the praise and worship team continues to pray, we're going to pray for one another today and just be led by the Holy Spirit on who you should pray for. And you know, there's power in your prayer. Say that with me. There's power in my prayer. Amen? Amen? The same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives on the inside of you. And so we're going to go around and we're going to pray for each other. And we're going to believe God for the things that we need to believe God for. And how many of you here today are overcomers? Raise your hand. Look at me. Are you overcomers? Right? We are. Amen.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Oh, great are you, Lord. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. We'll shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. Come on and lift your voice. All the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, and these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
It's your breath
in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Oh, great are you, Lord. Come on and tell him right now, Lord, you're great. Yes, you are great, are you, Lord. There is no one like you, Lord. You are great. Yes, you are great, are you, Lord. Oh, we worship you right now, Lord. You are great. Oh, great are you, Lord. Oh, yes, you are, Lord. You are great. How great are you, Lord? Oh, you're great, Lord. You are great. Great are you, Lord. One more time, tell him right now, Lord, you're great. Yes, you are, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Oh, yes, you are, Lord.
We just give you praise and glory and honor. And the people of the Lord said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. I just want to thank the worship team. Aren't they doing a great job? Just give them. Where's Tommy? Tommy, the Lord gave me a word for you. And this is what, and this, he just gave it to me just now. He said, the more you play for him, the more strength you'll get back in your body. He said, so every time you touch a key, strength comes to your body. That's what he told me. Amen. Praise God. Praise the Lord. So anyway, it's good to have you guys here. God is so good. There's so many things that are happening, and he's brought us here this afternoon so that we could worship him and be in his presence. Don't you sense the presence of the Lord? He's such a good God, isn't he? And he's so good to us. Amen. So a couple of announcements. I just want to remind everybody, Wednesday night Bible study is going to continue on October 3rd or 2nd. It's that first Wednesday in October, and we'll be meeting at Reset Church, where we've met in the past. And so we'll have prayer at 6 and then Bible study at 7. So mark your calendars for that first Wednesday in October. And it'll be good to get back in the swing of things. I hope you've had a nice break, and it's good to come back together in Jesus' name, right? Amen? All right, another announcement. Tomorrow is Labor Day. So I'm having a Labor Day lunch at my house. So it's from 2 to 6. And so we need a couple of things like ice and rolls and maybe some cookies, but a veggie tray or fruit. Or anyway, if you want to bring, just let me know what you're going to bring. I don't think it's going to be a big crowd tomorrow, but just let me know what you're going to bring so we don't all bring the same thing. Does that sound good? And let me know if you're coming. Anyway, it's going to be fun. So I already got the brisket, and that's what we're having tomorrow, so it's going to be good. Amen? Amen. And so another, we just want to hold up Lisa in prayer that a member of her family went on to be with the Lord yesterday. So just hold Lisa up in prayer and give her some words of encouragement this afternoon and be praying for her family this week as they make arrangements. And so anyway, several people are out of town. It's Labor Day weekend, and they're taking advantage of the holidays, and we want to pray for our brothers and sisters that are on vacation and doing things. And so just remember them in your prayers as they're having fun and out on the lake and that sort of thing. Anyway, God is a good God, right? He is so good to us. And so as we come to the Lord this afternoon with our tithes and offerings, I'm going to ask Carol to come up. And I just want to remind you how good God is to you, and that you can't outgive him, right? No matter, how do you know? You try to outgive God, what happens? He gives it right back to you. And so he's so good. And so Carol's going to come, and she's going to remind us of his goodness when we give, and how much he loves us and how he's always there for us. How can I not give to God? How can I not give to him? Amen?
I don't know about you, but I'm always excited to give to the Lord because he is, like Pastor Brenda said, he has done so much for us. You know, 3 years ago, of course, if you go here, you know that my husband passed away, and I went through a couple months of dark time, and because I was wondering, how am I going to do this? How am I going to make the payment on my house and all this stuff? But you know what? God supplied more. Let me say that again, more than I could have ever expected. My sister moved in with us, Gail, and she's been such a blessing to us. And I thank God for paying tithes. I taught Julie, And Tina, when they were younger, when you get a job, you're going to pay 10%. That's the first thing you do with your check or your money. You take that 10% out, you put it aside, and Sunday you give it to God. Amen? That's all I'm going to say. He's so good, and I love him so much. And I'm going to ask, let me see. Gail, how about you standing and asking God's blessings today?
Amen. Thank you, Anthony. He's coming around right now. Amen. Well, are y'all glad to be here today? I'm glad to be here today, too. God is a good God, and he's good to us, and he loves us, and he does things for us, and he's worthy of our praises. Amen? Okay, so give me just a minute. I just lost my sermon on my iPad. I don't know what's up with that. Yes, it happens. All right. Yay, it came back. Technology, right? Technology, it's wonderful when it works. It's not so good when it doesn't work, right? Do y'all have the same kind of experiences that I have here? You know, it's not so good when it works. So I was praying today about praying this week about what to preach on, and God gave me a lot of things, and but I'm just going to start with the very first thing that he told me. And one of the things that I've been hearing about, if you hear this Christian that was a Christian for a really long time, stepped away from the faith, or I don't know if you've heard recently, there was a guy that wrote a book, I won't say his name, he stepped away from the faith, or there's a worship artist, and he's been serving God, and then he stepped away from faith, and I go, what is going on, Lord? What is going on? And the word that God gave me was stand firm in the faith. Stand firm in the faith. And you know, our relationship with God is an everyday relationship. If you don't pay attention to your relationship with God, then you're going to grow cold, and you're going to grow apart from him. And so our relationship with God has to be cultivated, has to be tended to every single day. Just like in a marriage, if you don't talk to your spouse, then the next thing you know, you don't even know your spouse. If you don't talk to your children in your family, then the next thing you know, you don't even know what your children are doing. The same pertains to us in our relationship with God. We need to hear his voice in our lives every single day, and we need to get his direction in our lives every single day. Can you say amen to that? Amen. And so stand firm in the faith. That's the word that God gave me. 1 Corinthians 16:13, it says, be alert, stand firm in the faith, be brave, be strong. Wow. Those are some words that we need today in this time that we're living in. I don't know that if you know this, but we're living in the last days. Can you tell? All you have to do is turn on the news, and the next thing you know, you've heard this tragedy or that tragedy. And it's no secret that we're definitely living in the last days, and the events that occur all around us can lead us to believe that maybe all is lost. But I want to encourage you today and let you know that God has a plan. Say that with me. God has a plan. Now say this with me, and it's a good plan. And it's a good plan. It's a good plan for me. God has a plan, and it's a good plan. And in the midst of trials and tribulations and tragedies and heartache, God is with us. Amen. John chapter 14, verse 1, Jesus said, don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust in me. And you know, sometimes we don't have the answers for what's happening around us. Things happen to us, events happen. And I don't even pretend to know all the answers. But the one thing I do know, that I know, that I know, that I know, is that I know God and that he has all the answers and that I can trust him. And when I put my trust in him, even when I don't understand the events around me, or I don't understand why this happened, or I don't understand why this tragedy happened, I know that God loves me and that God is getting something to me and that God is bringing me peace. And he tells me for my heart not to be troubled. In other words, what is he saying to you? He's saying, I got a plan. I know. I got a plan. I know. So we can't, you know, say for everyone else. We can't say why this happened to this person or that happened to that person. But we can only say for ourselves. Amen? And so for me and my household, I'm going to serve the Lord. I'm going to put God first. And his plan is going to be activated in my life. And so if his plan is activated in my life, then he's given me the authority to take authority and dominion over evil spirits and over oppression and over danger and over tragedy and over the things that may come to harm us. Listen, we have a very powerful tool, and that tool is the blood of Jesus. And we can plead the blood of Jesus over us everywhere we go. In fact, I recommend that you plead the blood of Jesus before you go anywhere. I'm telling you, I can't remember how many times I've got into my truck. I plead the blood of Jesus over me and the truck before we go on our way. I have had so many narrow misses. You know, that's not a coincidence. I should have been hit by a car. I should have hit people. There's a lot of things that should have happened, but they did not happen because there's power in the blood. Amen? Not to mention over our own bodies, not to mention over our families, not to mention that there's power and protection in the blood of Jesus Christ. Do you believe that with me today? Say amen. And so God has a plan, and we must learn how to take authority over the devil. If we don't learn how to take authority over the devil, he will take authority over you. And it's just like that. He'll take advantage of you. And so you got to know what to do and how to do it. And as believers, it's vital to learn who you are in Christ. When you know who you are in Christ, the devil's not going to put one over on you. Amen? Because you know that you know that you know that you are a child of God. And if you are a child of God, a child, not just a child of God, you are a child of the Most High God. Amen? The Most High. There is nothing higher than God. No one else reigns but God. God is the final position in this universe, the highest place that you can go to. There's no one else. I am a child of the Most High God. That is who I am. So if I'm a child of the Most High God, then the most low, which is the devil, has no right to tell me what's going on in my life. Amen? So sickness and disease does not have a right to me. Amen? So oppression does not have a right to me. Amen? Depression has no right to me. Amen? I have the authority through the blood of Jesus Christ to say, get thee behind me, Satan, and I do, and you should too, right? Because we're children of the Most High God. He is our Lord. He is our Savior. So we got to learn how to take authority over the devil and learn what provision has been made for us. Once you learn these things, your faith begins to develop to a point where you understand spiritual warfare like never before. John 10:10, the thief comes what? Only but to steal, kill, and destroy. That's his job. But Jesus says that I have come that you might have life and life more abundantly. So God's plan for us is life. The enemy's plan for us is death, and it's just that simple. So God is life, the enemy is death. So taking your position and standing firm in the faith and see the deliverance. Taking your position is a battle term, and it means the location in which fire can be deliberated upon a target, the enemy. So it's a strategic location. putting you in a position to advance upon the enemy. So you can see in spiritual warfare that we too have to take our positions. And one of the things that happen in spiritual warfare, especially when the enemy surprises you, is that you're stunned and can't move. And the devil is planning his strategy on your responses. So as warriors in the kingdom of God, we have to train and be prepared for battle, because when it comes, because it's going to come. Look at your neighbor and tell him it's going to come. Like good soldiers in the military, we are in the army of the Lord, and we have to be ready for the battle. And part of the readiness is taking our position. So as believers, we need to learn how to take authority over the enemy individually, but we must also learn how to take authority corporately as the church. And that's why corporate prayer is so important. And corporate prayer is just not something that we do as Christians. It's not just a time that we get together. And I mean, it's all nice when we get together, but it's not just a cute thing, Christianese thing that we do. Corporate prayer is a place of power. When we come together, and pray. When I pray by myself, strongholds are broken and dominions are broken in the name of Jesus. But when we come together corporately, that is expanded. Amen. And so as we come together, like one soldier can fight. One soldier can come against the enemy. And one soldier can make a big difference. But isn't it better when there's a whole army? Amen. And so corporate prayer is the whole army of that church coming together, petitioning God for the same thing. Amen. Standing in faith for the same thing. Going to the throne room for the same thing. That's why corporate prayer is so important. It's because that church, let's say Word of Life, is taking her position, going boldly to the throne of grace and making our petitions known. We want to see things happen in this church, in this body, then corporate prayer is the place that we're going to see it happen. Can you say amen to that? And so, it's not a time of have to. It's not a time of drudge. It's not a time of duty. That's not what corporate prayer is about. It's a time of taking our position, and our position is on our knees, and our position is taking a stand, and our position is we're letting the devil say, hey, not here, not my church, not today, not my family, not today, right? Not my job, not today. We're telling the enemy that we're drawing the bloodline around our church, around our families, around us, around our lives, and that he doesn't get to come in and tell us how it's going to be. Amen. That's what corporate prayer does. And so today I want to encourage you, as we learn how to take authority over the enemy individually, we have to learn how to take authority corporately as a church. And the book of Ephesians shows us just how to do both, how to be a powerful believer and how to be the glorious church. I love Ephesians. If y'all know me, y'all know I love Ephesians. It's like my book. I love it. It's so powerful. And think about it for just a moment. The kind of church that Jesus is coming back for is the glorious church, right? Without spot or wrinkle, you know? Well, there's a lot of ironing that needs to be done on the bride's dress before Jesus can come back right now. What do you think? He's going to come back for a church without spot or wrinkle. And right now we have lots of spots and we have lots of wrinkles. We have lots of things to work out. But as we come together corporately and we not only pray for Word of Life, but we're praying for our country. We're praying for our state. We're praying for what's happening around us. And then we see the hand of God move. Can God move? Without our prayers, God can do anything. But what we are doing when we come together corporately, it was we're taking dominion over the enemy, and we're telling the enemy that he has to cease and desist. That's why they call it spiritual warfare. Amen. And so we're coming against the enemy. We're telling him to stop. No, you don't get to do this. Mm-mm. Stop. And as we do that, the enemy has to, what? He has to listen. And we say in the name of Jesus, he has to listen, he has to flee, and he has to do what he says. Why? Because all power and all authority have been given to us. Say that with me. All power and all authority have been given to me. If you're born again, that's what the word says. That's what the word says in Ephesians. It's been given to you. It's been given to you. And if it's been given to you, you're an overcomer, and there's no event in your life that you cannot overcome. And I'm not saying that the devil doesn't come and sucker punch you in the gut and that you're stunned and you don't know what's happening and you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. But I'll tell you one thing. I know one thing is that God knows what's going to happen in your situation, and he's a good God. Amen? And we can trust him. Say it with me. I trust God. Right. We trust him. We trust him with our lives. We trust him with our family. We trust him with every single area of our life. The information that can be found in Ephesians is vital, say vital, for every believer. It can mean life or death. We live in a day and age where you got to know who you are in Christ Jesus. You got to listen to the voice of the Spirit. Because in case you guys haven't noticed, there's crazy people out there. And if the Holy Spirit tells you not to go a certain way, you need to listen to the Holy Spirit. If the Holy Spirit tells you to stay home that day, you need to listen to the Holy Spirit. We need to have our ears tuned in to the Holy Spirit and let him shine that light on our path, because it could mean life and death for us and for our families. And I want to be in tune to what God is saying. Amen. And listen to what he has to say in my life. And so only through the church can authority be exercised over evil spirits that are working in this world. This world, in case you haven't noticed, is coming to end quick, right? And the church is the only hope. Us, the church, we're the only hope. People say it all the time. Where's the hope? It's with us. It's with us. We're the hope. What's the hope? It's Christ within us. The hope of glory, that's within us. And so as the times are getting darker, then the church is getting brighter. The church should be getting louder. The church should be getting bolder. The church should be getting stronger, because we're the only hope. Amen. Because of what Christ has done within us, there is no hope for this world outside of Christ Jesus. None. None whatsoever. And we see the enemy on a rampage, working in people that are mentally unstable, working in people who are demonic, working in people. Just as God uses people, so does the devil. And we've seen that displayed in our country in the last few weeks. And it tears our hearts out, and we cry out. We wonder, why is this happening, God? Why is this happening? It's happening because the church is not taking her position in corporate prayer. We need to step up our game. Amen? And so how do we step up our game? Well, I know all across the country, churches are stepping up their game. They're praying over their city, just like we do here in Riverside. They're praying over their schools, just like we do here in Riverside. They're praying over their state, just like we do here in Riverside. But we could say there's a lot of Christians that really haven't stepped up. They really haven't decided that they're going to do this. Oh yeah, they're a Christian. Praise Jesus. I'm a Christian. I love God. I go through my life. I go to work. I attend to my family. You know, I party a little bit, so I'm going to step over here on the world just a little bit, because I just got to let loose and have some fun, you know? I just got to have some fun and let my hair down. Y'all don't judge me, but come Sunday morning, I'm going to run back over here, and I'm going to raise a hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You're so good to me. There's no power in that life. And the devil knows it. And that's what's wrong with the church today. He's looking for people who will step up and decide to have some power in their life. If there's power in your life, there's holiness in your life. And if there's holiness in your life, there's righteousness in your life. And what am I saying? What I'm saying is clean up your act. If you really want to serve God, clean up your act and draw closer to Him. And as you draw closer to Him, these things of the world will fall away because Jesus has said it more than once. You cannot serve two masters because one's going to get you over the other. You got to make a decision. Amen? And so make a decision. Make a decision for God. Make a decision to put Him first in your life. And as you do, step out of the world. The world has nothing for you. The world has nothing there but sorrow and heartache and loss. If you want the real power in your life, then step in on into the Spirit and the things of God and allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you and begin to live a life of power, a life of prayer. If you have a life of power, that means you have a life of prayer. Amen. You have a life of prayer, you're going to have a life of power. And so I want power in my life. I want that connection to the Holy Spirit because God is a spirit and He speaks to us spirit to spirit. If God speaks me to spirit, that means I need to be in prayer to hear what He's saying. And He's saying a lot. God has a lot to say. He has a lot to say to me. He has a lot to say to you, and I want to hear everything that He has to say. Can you say amen to that? And so Ephesians, it tells us how to be the glorious church. And the answer is with the church, not the world. This world is this world, and we are the hope. We are the hope, not psychiatrists, not doctors, not government, but the church. So if there's going to be peace in your neighborhood and peace in your home and peace at your job, then it's you who's going to have to rule and reign from your heavenly place. And where is your heavenly place? Well, according to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6, it said, God raised us up with Christ and seated us with Him in heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. So we're seated with Jesus. Amen? In the heavenly place. Let's look at Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17. So that's a heaven, back to two, that's a heavenly place. What does that mean? Christ is the head. We're the body. We're seated with Christ. For some people, some Christians, this is a hard concept for them to grasp. It's not so hard for me to grasp. Christ is the head. We're the body. Okay, He's not a bodiless head, right? That means there has to be a body. Or He's incomplete, sitting on that throne at the right hand of the Father. Think about that for just a minute. So we are the body of Christ. He is the head. We have to sit there with them. Amen? And so that is our place of authority. Church hasn't learned that. We need to learn our place of authority. And we need to start positioning ourselves corporately in our place of authority and take authority over some things. Take authority over some things. Take authority over demonic shootings in our country. Can you say amen to that? Right? We need to take authority over that as the body of believers. Take authority over our schools and what's happening there. Take authority in our government and in California and what's happening there. Take authority over some things that are happening. We see what's happening around us. We're not helpless. We don't have to stand around and cry and believe all hope is lost and that there's nothing that we can do. And I'll tell you why. Because the same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. And that power is still alive and activated in the body of Christ. And as long as the Holy Spirit is here on this earth, and it is right now, then we have the ability to speak to those things, to speak to those mountains, to tell them to be removed and cast in the sea in Jesus' name. Amen. And so it's time we stepped up. Everybody look at your neighbor and say, step up. Step up. Amen. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17 and 23, it says, I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so you may know Him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. Who is us that believe? That's us, right? So this is talking to us. The power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at the right hand in heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things, say all things, under his feet, and appointed him to be the head over everything for the church, which is his body. That's us, the body, and the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. And so, 4 points about this. This is what I want you to grasp. We have the same power that raised Jesus from the dead that's living in us. That, think about it for just a moment. That same power. When I was able to go to Israel this past February, there's discrepancy about where the Garden Tomb is, where Jesus was buried, where he wasn't, and some believe it's in this church. I don't really believe that. Went to the garden, and you go in. As soon as you step into the garden, it's just a really beautiful, simple garden. You walk in, you feel the presence of God. When I went to the tomb, I walked in. It's nothing. It's just a slab of rock. That's all that's there. There's no signs. There's no nothing. It's a slab of rock. But when you walk into that tomb, and you have to, even I had to duck, you have to duck, and you go in, the presence of the Holy Spirit is so thick that you know, that you know, that you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that that is the place. Praise God. And so you stand there and you think of the power that raised Jesus from that slab of rock because God spoke to his dead, lifeless body and that he became alive. He heard that word and his dead, lifeless body became alive. That is the power that raised Jesus from the dead. And then you think about it just a moment, that power that raised Jesus from the dead, that is the same power that we who were once dead are now alive in Christ Jesus because we are born again. And so that same power that raised Jesus from the dead now lives in me, and no longer am I going to die, but I get to live forever in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah! That power. Say it with me, power. So we have the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. When Jesus was raised from the dead by that power, and Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father, and Jesus is above every principality and power and ruler. Hallelujah. So there is nothing that is higher than him. There is nothing that we cannot take authority over. There is nothing that we cannot come against. In Jesus' name, amen. We have the power. Look at your neighbor and say, I got the power. All right, so let's go. Y'all still with me? Are y'all still with me? One person still with me. One person. Wake up, you guys. Come on. Let's do this. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 and 10. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sin in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world. And now the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit is now at work of those who are disobedient. All of us lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh, following its desires and thoughts. And like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, aren't you glad? Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad he showed you mercy? Amen. But because of his great love for us, God is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. And it's by grace we've been saved. And God has raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you've been saved Amen. It's by grace. You've been saved. Not by works, so no one can boast. For we are God's handiworks, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance to do this. So, we were once dead in sin. But God loves us. By grace we've been saved, and God raised us up with Jesus. We're seated at the right hand of the Father with Jesus. Above, where are we seated? Well, Jesus is above every principality, power, and ruler, and authority. We're seated with him, so we're above every principality, power, ruler, and authority. And as we look in Ephesians, you know, the context of this whole letter is not divided up into chapters. It was a letter. Paul wrote it out as a letter. So it wasn't chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3. It was flowed continuously. And so when we see this whole letter not just divided up, we can see where Jesus is positioned and we can see where the church is positioned. Jesus, the head of the church, wherever the head goes, the body goes. So in context, we can begin to see our position when we go to chapter 6. And chapter 6 is the warfare, spiritual warfare chapter. Amen? And so here's what Paul established as we go in to chapter 6 of Ephesians. Paul established that Jesus was raised from the dead. He said that we have been raised from the dead. That Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. That we're seated at the right hand of the Father. That Jesus is above every power and authority. That we're above every power and authority. That Jesus is the head and the church is the body. Now, coming from that perspective, let's read chapter 6. Amen? Let's begin Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. So we can understand now why Paul says, finally, be strong in the Lord, in his mighty power. Finally, you know who you are. You know what you are. You are the church, the glorious church. You're seated at the right hand of the Father in Christ Jesus. Jesus is the head, the church is the body. So finally, be strong in the Lord, in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle, we rise above it. For our struggle is not with flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against powers and the powers of the dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you'll be able to stand your ground, and after you've done everything to stand, stand firm then. Stand firm then. Stand firm. Don't move. Stand where God has planted you. Stand strong. Be strong. Be bold. Speak up. Stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist. The breastplate of righteousness in place. With your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, which comes, which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. And with this in mind, be alert and always keep praying for the Lord's people. That's our instructions. That's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to take up our weapons. Points from this are, we aren't strong in ourselves, but we're strong in the Lord. Amen? The devil has strategies against you. He's trying to take you out and get you off God's path, period. That's all he's trying to do. Get you off the path of God. Get you distracted. Do you know distraction is the number one tool that the enemy uses to keep people off the path of God? The number two tool is offense. So if you're distracted and offended, you're going to get off the path. I'm just saying. And in the church, I don't know when we're going to get past offense and get past distraction so that we can do what God has called us to do. The devil has strategies against you. You cannot live like the devil and expect to exercise authority over him. So you can't party in the world and then come back in the church and expect to have power and authority over Satan. It doesn't work that way. You can't have one foot in church and the other in the world. Watch and pray. That's what God tells us. Watch and pray. Observe what's going on around you spiritually. Watch over what God has given you. You know, we got to pay attention. Look at your neighbor and say, pay attention. Have some situational awareness, not only physically, but spiritually. If you walk into a place and it doesn't feel right, guess what? It's not right. You need to get out of there. Listen to what the Spirit is saying to you. Does that make sense? Listen to the voice of God. This is how he leads us and guides us. Ephesians tells us to take authority over the enemy. We're dead in our sins. He's quickened us together, has seated us far above all principality and power, where he shares his throne rights with us, and tells us not to pray that God would do something about the devil. Did y'all know we're not supposed to pray that? That God to do something about the devil? But we are, why? Because we are to take authority over the devil. God's already done everything he's going to do about the devil. Amen. When he sent his son, Jesus Christ, Jesus said, I have come to destroy the works of the devil. Amen. And when Jesus came and he said it's finished on the cross and he descended into the kingdom of hell, then every knee had to bow and every tongue had to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and Satan had to hand over the keys to death, hell, and the grave to Jesus. The devil's been defeated. Hallelujah. He's been defeated. He's been defeated once and for all. He's always been defeated. He's never had a chance because Jesus came and made sure he was defeated. That's why we have the power and authority to take authority over the devil and over Satan, and know that when we speak the word, hallelujah, we're using our sword. And when we speak the word of God, it says it won't come back empty, and it will destroy everything the devil's trying to do in your life. Amen. But we have to pick up our sword, which is the word of God. We have to use it. Are y'all still with me? Amen. This is good. So we take authority over the devil. In all the letters written to the churches, Jesus says, you take authority over the enemy. You resist the devil, and what happens? He flees. But if you don't resist, he won't go anywhere. You got to cast him out. Be watchful. Be prayerful. Because the enemy is seeking to whom he can devour. If he can get you distracted, if he can get you offended, if he can get you broken, if he can get you wounded, if he can get you where you're isolated, and when you don't want any people around you, and you just want to lick your wounds and be like a wild animal, then that's when he pounces on you. Amen? Be watchful. Pray. He's seeking on whom he can devour. He's seeking to devour you. He's seeking to devour your children. Don't let him. That's what you gain for this. So that God will be able to say that in the ages he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and kindness through Christ Jesus. So take authority. Take your place. Be bold in the Spirit. Do what God has called you to do. Amen. So stand firm in the faith. It was paid with a great, great price, with the price of the blood of our Lord and Savior, so that we could be free. Be free. Don't let the bondages of sin hold you back. Aren't you tired of the bondages of sin? Aren't you tired of the same old thing holding you back, holding you back, holding you back, holding you back in fear, getting in your way, fear of rejection, fear of failure, fear of not succeeding? Fear of what people are going to. Aren't you tired of all of that? Be bold. Allow yourself to be free. Walk in the freedom. Then 1 Peter 9:5-10 says, stand firm then. Stand firm against him. Be strong in your faith. Remember that your family of believers all over the world is going through the same kind of suffering you are. Everybody's going through the stuff. Everybody's got some battle. Everybody's got something to overcome. Everybody's got some struggle. Everybody's got a place where the enemy is trying to hold you back. Everybody. But stand firm against the devil. Don't listen to his lies. Especially when God's trying to do something in your life. Don't be afraid. Be vulnerable. You know what vulnerable is? Vulnerability is being real with God, real with yourself, and real with others. Wouldn't it be great if we were just all real? Just who we are. With our struggles, with our mess, with our challenges, with our blessings, with our victories. And wouldn't it be great if, as the body of Christ, when you hurt, I hurt, when I hurt, you hurt? Or when you have a great victory, I'm happy for you, or if I have a great victory, you're happy for me. Isn't that how it's supposed to be in the body of Christ? But see, we're too busy trying to pretend like we all got it together. Just be real. Just be real with yourself, real with God, real with other people. And if you're real, you know what happens then? The enemy doesn't have a foothold in your life because you have nothing to hide. Amen? You're just you. Look at your neighbor and say, I love you. I love you, right? You're just you. And you get to be you. And you get to be who you are. So stand firm against him. Stand strong in your faith. Remember that the family of believers all over the world is getting through the same kind of suffering you are. Everybody's going through something. And in his kindness, God has called you to share in his eternal glory. Think about that for just a moment. That as a believer, we share in that glory. We share in his eternity. That we're going to live forever in the glory of God. This part on earth is just a little bit. The biggest part of our lives is coming after this. Amen. It's exciting. And so we share in that eternal glory by the means of Jesus Christ. So after you've suffered a little while, he will restore, support, strengthen you, and he will place you on a firm foundation. So I want to ask you today, how firm is your foundation? Is it solid? Are you standing on a solid rock? Or are you a little shaky? And as we come to prayer today, I just want to ask you, if you've never made Jesus the Lord of your life, today's your day. That you're going to live forever. You get to choose and decide where you're going to live. And you know, it's just that simple. It's not complicated. There's a heaven, there's a hell. Hell is hot, and heaven is not. And if you've been outside lately, it's really hot. I don't really want to experience that kind of heat, do you? And it's hotter than it is outside. Amen. And so if you've never made Jesus the Lord of your life, I just invite you to do that. It's the best decision that you'll ever make. Because he has a path of freedom for you. And it's a path of restoration. And a path of reconciliation. And he has a way of taking all the broken pieces of our heart and putting them back together. So today, as we come into the altar, let's come to the altar. Let's pray. Let's choose to walk in the freedom. Let's choose to stand firm in our faith. Let's choose not to waver. Let's choose to serve one master. And let it be Jesus. Because he's our King, he's our Lord, and he's worthy of our love. And he loves you very much. And I can be real with him, and he can be real with me. And you know what? Even when I'm real with him and he knows everything about me, he loves me anyway. Isn't that wonderful? He loves you anyway. And the power of that love is what we need in our lives because it gives us strength and it gives us the ability to stand firm and not be moved in a world that's shaking and sinking quickly. But praise God, we know that we have that eternal hope that we will live with him forever. Amen? All right, well, join me at the altar.
I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. All I am is yours. I'll stand with arms.
Wonderful week. I love you all. Be blessed. Be empowered. Remember, the same power that lives in him, where? Lives in you. Amen? Amen. So, Lord, we just come to you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your presence, and we thank you for your love. God, I ask that you bless each person that's here today. And, God, we thank you, and we give you all the glory. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen.